Ever since LoRaWAN is around, academics have been writing about it. Fascinating papers. But as most of you are very looking forward to the future, you don't have time to read all these academic papers, of course, and it's boring. So luckily for us, we have one guy lined up who done it for us, a literature review on everything on LoRaWAN. Fernando Kuipers is associate professor at the Delft University of Technology at the Intelligent System Department, the Faculty of Electrical Engineering, Mathematics and Computer Science. So, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Fernando Kuipers.
Thank you. I was asked by the Things Network to give a presentation about what the academic community has been up to when it comes to LoRaWAN. So that means that I have to speak about what others have done, basically, which is putting me a little bit out of my comfort zone. But I'll try to do my best anyway. And to make my life a little bit easier, I put in some of my own work as well along the talk. So as you all know, the Things Network started 2-3 years ago. LoRaWAN itself, it is a fairly novel technology, but still quite a number of papers have been published on the topic already. So that means that I have to make a selection on what to present. And by default, that also means that it's a biased one because I made that selection. So what I try to do is I try to look at different kinds of aspects and themes, and I decided to select 4 specific themes, basically work that has been done on sort of an experimental performance evaluation of LoRaWAN, second, work that has been done on sort of trying to get an in-depth insight into what kind of collisions occur. When do they occur? How do they occur? This third topic has been about simulators. Basically, simulators have been built and used to try to understand the scaling behavior of a LoRaWAN network. And then finally, different kinds of improvements that have been proposed in order to improve the technology. As you may notice, some topics are not there, topics like localization, topics like security, which of course are very important, but since they were already scheduled in the program, I decided not to focus on them for this particular talk. The papers that I'm going to present, I think each one of them already deserves an entire talk on really conveying the contributions of that particular work. I simply do not have the time in order to go in depth to explain all these contributions. So what I will do is just at a very high level give sort of a hint of the contribution of what those articles have proposed. And then at each slide I will give a pointer to a reference where you can look and read the paper for further details. So let me start by explaining a little bit about the first theme, which was about performance evaluations of LoRaWAN in the wild. And I think one of the first bodies of work that appeared there was from a Finnish group. You have to excuse me that I don't know how to pronounce the name of the first author listed there on this particular paper. They started working on trying to evaluate how LoRaWAN was performing in a real-life kind of setting. They did that. They started to do that in 2015 and 2016. They focused on some particular themes, one of them being the Doppler effect. So yesterday, Thomas Telkamp already explained a little bit what the Doppler effect is. It's basically a phenomenon that you notice when the source of a radio wave, for instance, is moving with respect to the observer, to the receiver. And this can cause certain kinds of artifacts which may hamper the correct reception of a particular signal. So the authors of this particular paper, they came up with a bunch of equations, tried to really know, okay, when does the Doppler effect cause a particular artifact, or when is it noticeable, so to say. They figured out that it depends on the time that you need to have in order to transmit a particular symbol. And that time is a function of the spreading factor and the bandwidth. So based on their calculations, they came to a sort of a magic number, saying that if you go faster than 38 kilometers per hour, and if you're using a spreading factor of 12, then you may notice the Doppler effect. Since it is a function of the spreading factor, they also saw that, okay, if you lower the spreading factor, so you go from 12 to 11, then this speed at which you notice the Doppler effect, this threshold, it doubles. So from 38, we go to 76 for SF11. I'm speaking about noticing, which is a bit of a fake term, perhaps. Because it doesn't mean that if you pass the threshold, all the traffic that you sent would get lost. On the contrary, I think yesterday we had a very nice presentation on, you know, LoRa from space, where we have speeds that are much faster than the 38 kilometers per hour. So it is sort of an indicative mathematical bound which they have used and computed, and based on that, they wanted to sort of verify whether it actually makes sense. So they started doing some experiments, and one of the experiments was putting a LoRa node on a disk and then, you know, turning the disk at different kinds of speeds. You can see the experiment setup that they had on the picture on the top of the slide. So they started spinning it, and at faster rotations, they indeed noticed certain artifacts. However, in the paper, they also mentioned that they didn't send enough packets to really have statistically reliable results. So I think there's still space for investigating the Doppler effect to a more extent or more carefully to know precisely what kind of effect it causes. Another experiment that they did, they also mounted it to a car and to a boat, just to also measure the velocity. And the experiment with the boat, for instance, there the boat was going at 9 kilometers per hour. There they noticed that they could receive the packets at a distance of 30 kilometers. So back then, and this was before the experiment of Thomas Telkamp and his balloon, this was quite an impressive achievement. But we know that now you can reach way further, up to hundreds of kilometers. The next paper is from a group in Italy, from Jova and her co-authors. And they looked at, well, the papers that were published on LoRa in that time. And they noticed that most of those papers were publishing about results performed in an urban environment. So they set out to measure the performance of LoRaWAN in a non-urban environment. And they were living in or working at least in the city of Trento in Italy, which has a lot of forests and mountains surrounding it. So they went to the forest and tried to measure the performance between two nodes, a sender and a receiver. They played with different kinds of power levels, but even going up to 20 dBm, they couldn't get much further than 90 meters distance. So this is, you know, for long range, not that long, and it illustrates that, you know, your surroundings really are a crucial aspect in the communication, to the point that even in this case, you know, the forest vegetation proved to be at least as hard as an urban environment. The next set of experiments that they did was more on an open plain, where they went to an airport and they also did some distance measurements. And they did it on separate days. On one day it was 24 degrees Celsius, on the other day it was 36 degrees Celsius. And what they noticed is that on the warmer day, the distance over which they could communicate was halved. So, as a result, they also noticed that the weather has a very could have a very big impact on your communication range in LoRa. So this was the first half of the paper. Then the authors tried to look at a different aspect, mainly the choice of antennas. So often measurements were done with the dipole, which is depicted on top in the picture here. Why? Well, perhaps because it's the standard one being shipped with the Semtech evaluation kit. But it is a quite bulky one, and it may not be the, you know, most suitable one if for specific kinds of applications. For instance, if you do wildlife tracking, then it may simply be too bulky and you might need to have different kinds of antennas. So they considered smaller antennas. And well, it comes as no surprise that it has an impact on what kind of antenna you use. So Fabian Ferreiro yesterday already touched upon that topic. The author's main finding there, or main conclusion, was that so these smaller antennas, they have smaller gains, and you can compensate by transmitting at higher power levels. That was also something that Fabian told us yesterday. So that could work in one direction, but the other direction, the downlink, of course, you don't have this particular feature that you can compensate for. So it creates sort of an asymmetry in the communication. So from urban to the forest, the next step was going indoors. Quite a number of papers have looked at the indoor environment, for instance, the one cited below here. Instead, as I said at the beginning of my talk, I'm also going to weave in some of my own work. So I will display or discuss some of the results that we have done at our university on indoor measurements. At our university, at our campus, we have a 22-story building, which is depicted on this slide as if it had fallen over. So nothing really happened to the building, at least not yet. The building consists of, well, as I said, 22 floors. On top of the building, sort of in this picture on the right, near the TU Delft logo, we had a gateway placed. The gateway, by the way, was given to us by Paul Dekkers, who I also saw here today at this conference from Surfnet. And basically, thanks to him, I started, and this gateway started to do some research on LoRa. But okay, back to the building. The gateway is placed all the way on top, and what we did is we had a node and we went to different kinds of floors in the building and to different ends. So the building is basically, if you look inside, it's one long hallway with offices to each side of it. So we considered six different floors at both ends of the hallway, and the results that we obtained was that, well, close to the gateway, everything is good, which is what we had expected. Going down, we saw a little bit of a deterioration in the useful signal power that we were measuring at the gateway, but not as much as we had expected. You are not seeing a continuously decreasing line. The reason being that at some point, at some floor, due to all the concrete of our building is like a Faraday cage in terms of wireless reception, it's poor. But because of that, you know, the signal cannot go through all these layers of concrete. What happened is, well, basically, the signal started to reflect from another building 100 meters further away back to our building. So we had a fairly stable reception at the lower parts of our building. So Multipath basically came to the rescue here. A lot of the results that had been done and still have been done focus on small-scale experiments. A bunch of nodes, a bunch of gateways, and then basically trying to infer from that certain kinds of behavior, which of course is very useful, but sometimes you might want to get a perception of a little bit of a bigger scale. So what we did is in the starting from December 2015, we started to crawl the data from the Things network, basically from data from generic devices. So what are generic devices? Those are devices that use default keys. They do not need to be registered, nor do they need to have an associated application. Often what we noticed is that they were also not sending their data encrypted, so we could have a nice look at the payloads, which was nice for us, of course. So in a specific time frame from December 2015 until July 2016, we grabbed from all the from the TTN network all the data from devices, generic devices using a specific key. Back then, this was possible with the API of the Things network. We could also have access to the gateways to get their status updates, etc. This resulted in more than 17 million frames that we captured. So, as you know, some of these frames may have been received by multiple gateways, so we also looked for unique frames. Looking at the database, turned out that these frames were generated by 1,618 devices and were received by almost 700 gateways. So we started to analyze the data set that we had obtained. And then we saw basically results that reflected that this data set was a data set from the fairly early days of the Things network, meaning that I think that most people were just playing around a little bit with it, trying to test it, see what happens. For instance, if we look at the figure on the left, we see that the majority of users had sent less than 10 packets in this, you know, half a year time span, which is not much, even though there's a duty cycle, you know, you could do more than 10 packets. Also, if we look at other things like the distribution of spreading factors and the distribution of frequency usage, we see a fairly uneven distribution, which again, probably is simply folks using default settings, no ADR being in place, etc. You know, this gave us a nice data set, nice insights, but probably not really representative of a production level kind of network. So I think it would be really nice to repeat this kind of study with a more accurate, up-to-date data set. And fortunately, you know, I'm working at a university. There are a lot of students there. I found a student called Priyanka, who should also be here somewhere, who started recently to do her thesis work at the Things Network to do just that, to do a bit of a data analysis on the rich data set that they have over here and seeing what we can do with that particular insights. As I also said, a lot of the data was not encrypted. So we also had a look at the payloads to see what was in there. And we noticed that there's, well, basically a common info that you might expect, sensor data, GPS readings, etc. Also some common strings like test, etc. But I always wondered whether someone had built an application to get him or herself some coffee delivered via the LoRa network. Because there was a particular string shouting at least 172 times, coffee, coffee, coffee. Since LoRaWAN is using for the channel access an ELOA type of protocol, collisions can occur. So it's important to understand, when can collisions occur, what is the effect, etc. So if two frames arrive on the same carrier frequency, the same spreading factor, the same bandwidth, this may cause a collision and both packets may be lost. I'm saying may because in some cases, depending on the power settings, the precise timing, some of the packets may still be received. And this is what we call the capture effect. And this is an effect that has been studied by Bohr and some others, where they did a number of experiments with basically one receiver, two transmitters, a weak one and a strong one, and the difference between weak and strong was 1 dBm. And they also used a time offset, so the weak one was transmitting at a particular time. The strong one was either a time frame before or after. So they did that over multiple times and plotted that in this particular figure. So if we look here, we see the packet reception rate being plotted. And if we look to the left, so the negative values, this basically means the strong signal or was transmitted before the weak one. Then we see that the packet reception rate is 100%, meaning that the strong packet always survived. And if we look a bit to the positive side, we see that often these packets get lost. So we wanted to understand this notion of capture effect a little bit more and started to do our own experiments. We did it for a single gateway and then playing with different power levels and also playing with line of sight or not. And as I said, because a gateway or and there may be multiple gateways, and sometimes if a collision happens at one gateway, another one may still relay your data and you may still correctly receive it. So we also looked at the packets, whether it was correctly received at the application. So we checked for the message integrity code. We also looked at interfering networks. So could another network, a packet being sent from another network, interfere or cause collisions on, for instance, the network of TTN? Some of the observations that we obtained were as follows. And if we look at the top one, we see top one, N1, is the weaker frame, N2 is the stronger frame. If the packet, the stronger packet, arrives, let's say, at least four symbols after the weaker frame, these four symbols relate to a lock, then both frames get lost because the receiver tries to lock on to the weaker frame, but its signal is being disturbed by the stronger frame. So both frames are lost. And if the stronger frame arrives a bit later, after the preamble, but overlapping with the header CRC, then it may be the case that the stronger frame survives, because the header CRC of the weaker frame gets corrupted, then the lock on that particular frame is released immediately, and it is starting to lock onto the stronger frame. If we shift it even further in time, the stronger frame may start to overlap with the LoRaWAN header. In that case, both packets are lost because the receiver tries to lock on to the weak frame, but its LoRaWAN header gets corrupted, and then both are lost. In the final case, if the stronger frame arrives during more or less the payload of the weaker frame, also both are lost, but if it arrives really late, at the last bit of the CRC payload of the weak frame, then it can still be the case that the weak frame is correctly received. So collisions happen. They can happen for all sorts of reasons, and it's obvious that the more nodes are appearing, the higher the chance of collision. So in order to study this scalability effect, the growth of networks, a lot of researchers have turned to simulators. I'm going to be brief about the simulators listed on this particular slide, and only going to say that they all conclude that scalability is an issue. And if you take into account that they didn't incorporate things like the weather, the temperature, for instance, or other dynamics inherent to the environment, then the message really is that scalability of LoRaWAN needs to be studied further. Fortunately, some folks have done just that and started to propose improvements to LoRaWAN, which of course I think is the most exciting part of the work that has appeared in the scientific literature. One of the works was from Paul Marcellus, who was a student at TU Delft and who I also saw at this conference today. He realized that in the end, it's all about the data. You want your data to be received correctly. It's not about frames being lost and then you trying to have to recuperate those. You could try to do that by having some sort of retransmission scheme, but this is quite costly, as is depicted on this particular slide, because you have a lot of transmissions going back and forth. So they proposed an application layer coding scheme, and basically what they did is they added a little bit of extra information from, you know, basically previous data to the current transmission, and in doing so, you of course increase the size of the frame, but this is an investment, so to say, that pays off. They could show that it is more efficient than this retransmission scheme. The other piece of work I would like to tell you about is, for that you have to understand chirp spread spectrum. Well, I think Matt Knight gave an interesting talk recently, so I guess you most of you will know that. So let me jump straight to the contribution of a particular paper. There were some folks from Carnegie Mellon University who looked at LoRa devices, and they realized that, well, these are cheap devices, and these cheap devices, they don't have necessarily the best oscillators there. So in practice, you see different kinds of frequency offsets between those devices. Those frequency offsets are quite interesting because they could, with their methodology, sort of disentangle the packets that would collide at a specific gateway by simply taking those frequency offsets into account. So hardware imperfections are actually good in this case. Another interesting piece of work that they did in the same paper was that they said often sensors are deployed in a setting where they are placed in vicinity of each other. For instance, temperature sensors in this particular room would monitor more or less the same value. Well, these particular sensor values might be out of range of a gateway. However, if you combine that those data, if you correlate it to some sense, and that is what they've done, they have done some signal processing and some other clever techniques, they were able to sort of extend the range of correlated data. So instead of, for instance, sending those three values, these couldn't be received normally. But if you look at the aggregate value of those which were combined, these signals were united to come above the noise floor, then you could receive them over a longer distance. So they've extended the range. The last slide and the last paper that I would like to highlight is trying to push down the costs and power consumption of the LoRa devices even further. And they're doing that by using a technique called backscatter. Backscatter devices are very energy efficient because they basically use existing radio signals to power themselves. What they do, a device is basically reflecting a signal, a radio signal that arrives at it, and it's modulating it along the way. So it's putting on that reflected signal, its own signal that it wants to transmit. It can do that very efficiently. This is not a novel technology, so backscatter communication is quite popular these days. But what these researchers have been able to do is to really extend the range, because previously backscatter was only on a small distance. And now, with LoRa backscatter, they could do that over hundreds of meters and even up to a couple of kilometers. The nice thing also is that you only need one radio source, which can be used by multiple backscatter devices. So it really is a technology that could be useful in dense kind of scenarios. So I hope to have conveyed that there's quite a bit of interesting work going on in the academic community, and it definitely hasn't stopped yet. I haven't been able to list all the references that I have encountered, so I will place a number of pointers at an existing link that the Things Network already has, but it only contains 4 citations, so I'm going to beef up that number a bit with all the papers that I've encountered. And with that, I would like to thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Fernando Kuipers. And I'm sorry to say you too took all the time for your presentation. So no more time for questions. Sorry for that, but thank you very much for this oversight. And please copy the link if you want to go through all the literature.